The Audi Quattro Group B rally car is possibly one of the most iconic cars from the Group B era. Yet, moving on in time, we see very few of these cars around, mainly because they were never available off the showroom floor. And as it turns out, creating a replica of these cars is quite a serious effort. In fact, it actually involves two cars to make the conversion. Face value, the Group B car simply looks like an Audi Quattro with a shortened wheelbase. However, once you dig a bit deeper, there's actually a little bit more going on. In the Group B era, Audi actually produced prototypes that were based around this shortened Audi Quattro. However, in testing, the drivers complained about the amount of sunlight that was coming in through the windscreen due to the large rake-back angle on the screen. So the correct way of producing a replica is to use an Audi 80 two-door front half coupled to the rear end from an Audi Quattro coupe. The Audi 80 front end has a much more upright windscreen, which fixes the light problems that the drivers were complaining about. So as you can see, producing one of these replicas is a serious amount of work, and obviously there's a lot of bodywork modifications required. Then on top of that, there's also the large flared box guards, as well as that massive rear wing to consider. The power plant for the car is a 20-valve, 2.2-litre, 5-cylinder engine sourced from an Audi S2. Of course, this is modified with a host of aftermarket components to make it reliable, as well as to ensure it's capable of producing the 750 flywheel horsepower that it needs to be competitive. Internally, it uses a Farndon crankshaft, along with a set of Wossner pistons and forged conrods. The cylinder head has been ported and polished and fitted with a set of Supertech valves. These are larger than the stock valves to improve airflow in and out of the combustion chamber. The camshaft arrangement in this engine is a little unique in that there is a single cam drive from the crankshaft, and the intake cam is driven off the exhaust cam via a chain drive. Both cams are adjustable independently, although with this particular drive setup, it is a little bit more challenging. There's a vernier adjustable cam pulley on the front of the exhaust cam, and then there's another vernier adjustable cam pulley on the front of the intake cam. The intake cam allows the lobe separation angle to be adjusted, and then the vernier cam pulley on the exhaust cam allows both cams to be advanced or retarded together. Due to the larger, more aggressive cam profile fitted, the factory hydraulic lifters have also been replaced with a set of solid lifters. Solid lifters are more suited to high RPM use, however, they are a little bit more maintenance intensive than a factory hydraulic lifter. In order to ensure engine reliability under the high cornering, accelerating and braking forces seen in competition, the factory oiling system has been replaced with a VRS dry sump system. This starts with a CNC machined aluminium sump, which includes several scavenge stages feeding to the dry sump pump. The scavenge stages remove the oil from the engine crankcase and then pump it rearward into the boot mounted oil reservoir. Oil is then drawn forward from that reservoir by the pressure stage on that pump. The dry sump pump is driven off the front of the crankshaft. This all ensures that regardless of the cornering forces, accelerating forces or braking forces, a constant supply of high pressure oil is always available to the engine. The turbocharger system starts with a Garett GT3582R roller bearing turbo and boost is controlled via a TurboSmart external wastegate. At sea level back in the UK, with 1.9 bar of boost, the engine produces 750 horsepower, but of course at the higher altitudes at Pikes Peak, this power level will drop significantly. Maintaining a constant supply of fuel is essential in order to ensure reliability at 750 horsepower and 1.9 bar of boost. And this starts with an ATL fuel cell that's mounted in the boot. The fuel is then drawn from the cell and feeds into a surge tank, and from here, dual Bosch 044 pumps are used to pump the fuel forward to the fuel rail, which is fitted with a set of Rochester 1600cc injectors. The electronics package controlling the car starts with the MoTeC M800 ECU, which is responsible for controlling the engine as well as the boost pressure. The MoTeC C125 dash logger is fitted as a driver display as well as a central logging hub. One of the aspects that's really important with any dash logger is how the driver actually uses it. While a vast amount of information can be displayed on the C125 dash logger, under competition use, there's simply no time to look at any of that. Instead, the driver's going to be concentrating most of his energy on controlling the car while watching the shift light module that's going to signal when a gear change is required. The dash logger, however, can monitor a wide array of data, and if any of the parameters go outside predefined conditions, a driver warning can be illuminated. This instantly brings the driver's attention to the fact that something isn't right, then he can look at the dash to find out exactly what the error is and decide on an appropriate course of action. This can easily save an engine if something goes wrong, and can make the dash logger seem like a very cheap investment on an expensive engine. Getting 750 horsepower to the ground reliably is no simple feat, and here the Audi engine is backed by a 6-speed sequential drag power systems gearbox. This also includes the ability to flat shift using a strain gauge that's fitted to the gear lever assembly. This strain gauge gives the MoTeC M800 ECU a signal when the driver is pulling back on the lever to initiate an upshift. Under these conditions, the driver can stay at full throttle and doesn't need to use the clutch. When the driver pulls back on the lever, the M800 ECU will momentarily cut the ignition to the engine, allowing the next gear to be engaged. This provides really seamless shifting, and also with a large turbo, prevents the turbo falling off boost. Downshifts in this case do require the clutch, or at least a rev match, and in this particular instance, the engine is fitted with a conventional cable throttle body, so this makes it a little bit trickier for the ECU to initiate a downshift auto blip. In this case, this is still done the old-fashioned way by the driver. The Audi is also four-wheel drive, so the output from the drag power systems gearbox is split both front and rear. The centre differential split is a fixed 50-50, and the front and rear differentials are actually stock Audi open differentials. The cooling system in the Audi Quattro Group B is actually quite unique in that the radiator, which we'd normally find at the front of the car, is now mounted in the boot. This actually helps with weight distribution, as there's a fair amount of water held in that radiator. Getting sufficient airflow through to the boot-mounted radiator does require a fair amount of work, and this is where some of the ducting in the large box guards comes in. Now, when competing at sea level back in the UK, the ducting that's on the car has proved absolutely fine. However, when competing at high altitude, such as at Pikes Peak, with a thin air, this has actually presented a problem, and the team have found that the car was running a lot hotter at high altitude. This has been fixed at the moment by blocking off some of the outlet ducting from the boot, forcing more of that cooling air that's being drawn in through the radiator. Despite the amount of work that's required to create an authentic Audi Quattro Group B replica, we're glad that there are enthusiasts out there around the world who are prepared to put in the hard yards, and we wish Keith and the team all the best for the 2018 running of Pikes Peak.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.